Proverbs chapter 16. The preparations, the purposes, the preparations to get ready of the heart in man, preparing the heart, and the answer of the tongue. Trying to find my notes here. Of the tongue is from the Lord. When you study to show thyself approved unto God, the workman that needs not to be ashamed, but rightly dividing the word of truth, the answer will come through the Holy Spirit. And when you've dealt with somebody at any time, and you've given your mouth and your tongue to the Lord, then you'll be amazed on how much the Holy Spirit will fill it. And you'll walk away from that conversation realizing that you were used of God at that moment and it wasn't you. All the ways of man are clean in his own eyes. That means when man sees what he's doing, his religion, his accomplishment, his science, his education, hey, that looks good. Romans 3:23. Isaiah 64:6. But the Lord weigheth the spirits. One day God's going to call each man up. And he's going to bring that way that man has. Now it says a man. A man can have many ways. He can have religion. He can have science. He can have science. He can have education. And God's going to weigh it out by Jesus Christ. And man will be found wanting. Now what about those that never heard? Well, God's going to give their ways, and he's going to weigh it by Jesus Christ. And you know what? It may be found equal. The conscience. And that's a whole study in itself. But man thinks what he's doing is so pure and so great. Especially when it comes to sporting and then movies with their awards and all that. God says, I'll weigh it out one day. I'll check it out. With that, we find, commit thy works unto the Lord. 2 Corinthians 10:3. And thy thoughts, the result. And thy thoughts shall be established. You got a thought problem? Commit the works unto the Lord. You can't be in the ways of man, a sin, for all his sin comes short of the glory of God, and have clean thoughts. You got a problem with your thoughts, put yourself and thy works unto God. Now, one way to get rid of indecent thoughts, let's say you got dirty thoughts. Put away the television and the computer. Give that to God. What I'm saying is, change your behavior with the television. Turn off the television. Change your behavior with the computer. Put up good things. Put a parent block. Put a nudity block on your computer that it won't come up. That you got to bypass your security code or whatever that program is. Then give your computer to God and let God control the thoughts. The Lord has made all things for himself. Galatians 1:16, the Lord Jesus Christ. John chapter 1. Yea, even the wicked for the day of evil. Now that is a John Calvin verse. And if you go to verse 6. And we'll look at that in a minute. Verse 6, you go two verses and it will disprove Calvin's verse. Judge not, lest you be judged. See, people don't go any further. They don't read further. Now, chapter 16, verse 9, when we get there. But yea, and wicked for the day of evil. Pharaoh, Exodus 3:19, 4:21. Ahab, 1 Kings 22. Everyone that is proud in heart. Everyone that is proud in heart. I'm a born again Christian. Yeah, look at all the numbers we got in our church. That doesn't just say Jews. Everyone is an abomination. You remember when we read about abomination the other night? The evil man, his evil ways? You could be a saved Christian, have pride, and you are an abomination to the Lord. You want an interesting study, maybe I'll do it one day, is go through the Bible, just go through the word abomination, find out what you find. Though hand join hand, a pair, handshake, sports is a proud, he, singular. Hand join hand is a pair, he shall not be unpunished. You mean if I'm a Christian, I got pride in my heart? There's no but in that sentence, in that verse. You will be punished. And though you join hand with someone else in pride and get a congregation, you will stand before God alone and give an account. You can have a whole congregation of Christians and be prideful, and God will call you out one by one. I told you. Pride is never of God, and you will be judged for your sins. By mercy and truth, iniquity is purged. And by the fear of the Lord, men depart from evil. Well, if Calvin was right, what if a guy who wasn't saved feared the Lord and departed from evil? What would he get? The Bible says mercy and truth. When a man's ways please the Lord, okay, you can have a man in his way please the Lord. Not all of man's ways are wicked. But what we study so far, vast of them are. Religion is a way of man that's deaf. You can have education a way of man and it pleases the Lord when you teach people right the Bible. The right Bible. That will please the Lord. You don't see anybody in the Bible holding a sign on a pole. But somebody started that way and the Lord's pleased with it. He maketh even his enemies to be at peace with him. A peace that the world can't give. A peace that the enemy cannot give. Only God gives. Better, we looked at the other night, better is a little with righteousness. See, Paul had very little. Yet in glory he had very much. And people won't get that. They will go into the world because Christianity, the true Christianity, I don't see the results now. So they run to the worldly ways where they see the results then. Then great, Luke 16, Luke 12, and Luke 18, great revenues. Oh, look what I have. I'll tear down all the barns and say, soul rest, thou fool. The rich man was dressed in supplement clothes and sat at the table and ate. Without right. You can have all the money in the world, but if it ain't right, it's wrong. Better have 2 pence and give it to the Lord than just to have abundance. Because God will recognize you with the 2 pence. A man's heart, not head, so you don't go see a shrink. When you go to a head doctor, you're going to the wrong, right there, according to the Bible. When you get a Bible-believing pastor, he deals with the heart, not with the head. Devises his way. Deceiveth his way. That's a free will, Calvin. Mr. Calvin! That's a free will. He doesn't have to walk that way. But the Lord directeth his steps. What you want, God will give you in your free will. You want idols, God will give you idols, according to your wicked heart. You want a false witness, God will give you a false witness, according to your heart. A divine sentence. 1 Peter 1:4, God. Acts 16:16, Satan. A divine sentence is in the lips of the king. You can't have that in America. We've got a president. And we definitely got a president because we did not want a king. See, a king is a monarch. Absolute rule. We want somebody to be a leader of our country that we can per se, we can vote on him, we can move him to do what we want. Boy, has it failed. His mouth, the king's mouth, transgresseth not in judgment. Romans 13:1-3. Capital punishment is a divine sentence. According to the Bible. And we've got a country where there is no capital punishment, so there's no divine sentence in a president. A just weight and balance are the Lord's. All the weights of the bag are his work. Leviticus 19:35. Now, just weight means everything being equal to what it says it's supposed to be. If it says a pound, it better be a pound. You know, having 2 systems of measurements is not a Bible thing. It's a contrast when you got a standard and metric. You got to have either or. To make a guy go out and buy, you know, 2 sets of socket wrenches, so you can make money on the sucker, and then have other, you know, a standard and a Phillips screwdriver, and have 200 other kinds of screwdriver ends. That's not a just weight or balance. All right, he's bought all our socket sets. Now let's come up with a new one now. So you gotta go buy those. It's illegal. It is an abomination to presidents, I mean kings, to commit wickedness. Let's see, having a beer, romancing with a secretary, starting an illegal war, having your wife control the whole White House by, a wizard or, you know, fortune telling. I mean, come on. It is an abomination to kings to commit wickedness, not in America. You vote them back in office for another term. And no, I'm not just speaking about the present president. For the throne, we don't have a throne. We don't have a throne prepared for the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords to sit. We got an Oval Office. Why? Why would you have an Oval? What is so Oval Office? Oh, I know, Easter bunnies, the great sex worship. Maybe. That's the only thing I can think of when I think of Oval. Is established by righteousness. So America was established on righteousness. Where's the throne? I just kicked some people's butts right now with America. You know, God bless America. Where's the throne? Didn't say desk. Righteous lips. Well, I guess we get off the subject. Joseph, Jesus, Nathan, Daniel are the delight of kings. Really? I mean, if I were to walk up to the President of the United States in any time period and say, believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, thou shalt be saved, and you're a sinner, and you need to repent, do you think he'd be delighted? I couldn't get up to him with the Secret Service. And they that love him, that speaketh right. Righteous lips are a delight of kings, and they that love him, that speak right. You want to see how much they love you when you speak right? Go on the street and go on somebody's doorstep and knock on their door and tell them about Jesus. See how much they love you in America. The wrath of a king is as the messengers of death. I don't see America. When was the last time the death of a person's soul, or body, excuse me, was resulted upon the president's wrath? Oh yeah, I forgot when they were burning oil fields in Iraq. And there was somebody that had weapons of mass destruction, so we went over there. Yeah, okay. I guess. You know, a Christian that was from a certain elite college involved in the Bones and Skulls Club. Yeah. Okay. Sure. But a wise man will pacify it. Daniel 3. You know, the king was angry. I want every magician killed in this county. Every one of them. Because they can't answer my dream. Daniel steps in and says, O king, let me help you, please. So, Proverbs 16:14, study Daniel 3. And any other king that gets angry, someone steps in. David, man, how dare that guy steal the sheep? He gets 4 sheep. And Nathan says, you done with your fit? Yeah, I'm done. Thou art the man. In the light of the kings, oh, this is kings. In the light of the king's countenance, his face is light. Imagine the king's face when he changed, when he looked at Nehemiah and says, you know, here he's happy, he's got his wife, and Nehemiah, why do you look sad? Now that countenance just changed. He's not angry, but he's got a face that looks like very concerned. Why are you not joyful? And Nehemiah would look at that king's face like, oh, I am one more step to death if he gets angry. What if the president of the United States, like a kingly authority, say, listen, all you people who want to badmouth me, even if you are Bible-believing, born-again Christian, you want to badmouth me, listen, your Bible says you're not to do it. I'm going to put you in a sentence of death. Oh, got the Constitution, got the right to free speech. But the Bible says, curse not your leader, curse not the king. Paul says, pray for him. Under Nero. Now, if you put Nero and President Obama together, President Obama's a sweet little kitten having a little glass of milk. Nero believed in campfire Christians as he would put you in a bowl and put tar on you and light you up and say, I'm having a party with the light of the world, the Christians. And Paul said, go read Romans 13, go read what he told Timothy, you are to pray for your leaders. You are to support them. And then read the rest of the chapter, 3 or 4 verses of Romans 13. It says he's the sword of vengeance, capital punishment. You know, according to the Bible, if President Obama says, I'm sick and tired of you guys making fun of me in my office, I'm putting you to death, the Bible says he has that right. And you'll get to heaven and go, oh, the Bible says you aren't supposed to say nothing about him. Now let's check how many times you prayed about him in the books. Open the books. You know? We don't have a king, we have a wimp. That guy's dictated by the media. That guy's dictated by the house. That guy's dictated. We ain't got no leader. All right. The light of the king's countenance is life, and his favor is as a cloud of latter rain. Second Advent passage. As that rain that you need, that's his favor. You know, there was a king in the Old Testament. He said, you know, this woman that Elijah, you know, took care of her son. He raised from the dead. There was a famine. She comes back to the king. He says, let her have her land. There's a king that Jesus speaks about. That woman, you know, let me have. You know, man, just get this woman out of my way. I'm going to give her what she wants. That says Elijah rain. It's needed. How much better is it to get wisdom than gold? Much better. Because wisdom can get you gold and get you it honestly. And to get understanding rather than chosen than silver. You can understand, you can get silver. And you can get it righteously. But the more gold and silver you get, the more someone's going to look at you and they're going to want to get it from you. Gold and silver shows up at the judgment seat of Christ as rewards. The gold is walked upon on the streets of New Jerusalem. Now, I don't know if there's silver mentioned in New Jerusalem. I'm not sure if that's one of the stones. I don't think it is. Silver is redemption. Gold is king, monarch. That's why we don't have a gold standard anymore in America. We got paper. That doesn't mean nothing. With a bunch of dead men on there that you worship as idolatry. Oh, this is my money. You know what Jesus said? He said, show me a coin. Now here it is. Whose image is on it? Caesar. Well, give it to Caesar. Yeah, Jesus came to America and showed me a piece of money. Whose money is this on it? Well, George Washington. Well, give it to George Washington. He's dead, so it means it's mine. You see what I mean, Jelly Bean? See, America's smart by putting dead men on their money. You can't go give it to President Obama if his picture ain't on it. Change all the currency with each president. Then we have to get to the Bible. We'll have to render the things to God that are God's and render the things that is presidents to presidents. I guess. Well, I'm going off track tonight. The highway of the upright. And it's the Holy Spirit leading. That's the only thing I can say. The highway of the upright is to depart from evil. Isaiah 35:8. But you want to get on the highway of life? According to Jesus, according to the Bible, leave evil. Get off the broad way and go onto the highway with Jesus Christ. He that keepeth his way. Again, that matches a man. Where is it? When a man's ways please the Lord. Verse 7. He that keepeth his way. It's got to be God's way because it preserveth his soul. The eternal part of you. The contrast you would get from this verse would be righteousness. Depart from evil. Evil, the opposite of evil is righteousness. You don't want to depart from righteousness. You want to depart from evil. That means you're doing righteousness. Pride goes before destruction. Destruction comes to pride eventually. Because it's an abomination to the Lord, verse 5. Be humble before you stumble. And an haughty spirit before a fall. Whether you're a church, you're a country, you're an individual, you're saved, you're lost. Pride and haughtiness will bring you to a fall and or destruction. Destruction in a fall is the reaping of the sowing of pride. Nothing good comes out of it. Better to be of an humble spirit, with verse 18, better it is to be of a humble spirit. Let's read it. Pride goes before destruction, and a haughty spirit before a fall. Better it is to be of an humble spirit with the lowly. People who are humble. Don't get into prideful people. Don't get into prideful crowd. Don't get into a prideful congregation. Then to divide the spoil with the proud, chapter 1, verses 12 through 14. I'm willing to assume there have been churches that have their pride in numbers, that there have been fights and discord because if someone gets saved and someone trying to get the credit for it. You know, all the blues come down from the sky. You're the 100th person that was saved in this church. You're the 1,000th person saved in this church. You're the 1 millionth person saved in this church. And for you, the baptism will be room temperature. Well, I've seen a Christian get mad and leave church. Because they witnessed to somebody, that person came to church, got saved by another person, and that person got mad because he didn't get saved by him. I hope you understood what I just said. He got mad because someone else led him to the Lord. That's proud. That's pride. That's the Pharisees. Stretch out your crooked arm. Wow, look at that.
Look what Jesus did on the Sabbath day. Come on, boys, let's go kill him.
See, that's the problem with the Pharisees. Over envy, they turned Jesus over to Pilate. It was pride. It was envy. And the result was death to a righteous, just, sinless man. That is what pride and envy and what we're reading now will turn to. It will kill somebody, and then God will bring judgment upon you. Makes you think you're better than who you are. You know, when I look at man, and I see somebody, you know, maybe this is cruel, but I'm sure, but everybody sits down to go potty. You know? Science has not approved the way we go to the bathroom. They may give you a cushy seat, but still, you know what? Everybody gets a throne in their life, I guess. Okay. Pride goes and divide the spoil with the proud. Now, don't you think you're going to have a hard time with that one? One for you, one for me. Two for you, one, two for... Wait a minute. Why do you get two and I get... Well, it was my idea. No, it wasn't. Three for you, one, two, three, four. Hey, what are you doing? You know? And you're not going to fight with him because he may kill you. Remember chapter 1? They were going to kill somebody for the money? Well, if they're going to kill somebody for the money, why not kill you? He that handleth a matter wisely shall find good. So every matter that comes to your life, read it again. He that handleth a matter wisely shall find good. Every matter that comes to your life, you better handle it good. You better handle it wisely, because you will be judged at the judgment seat of Christ. I have been handed 2 children in my life. Some have 1, some have 3, some have more, some have none. I have a matter of a son and a daughter. I better handle them wisely to expect good at the judgment seat of Christ. He that handleth a matter wisely shall find good. You know a matter I'm going to be found guilty of? A matter? Food. Food's a matter. I have not eaten the proper foods that I should have. I'm guilty. I have even wasted food. That's not wise. And I will not get a good at the judgment seat of Christ. Do you really think that God will judge you on what you do with food? Oh, I guarantee it. We don't realize the half of what we're going to be judged at the judgment seat of Christ as Christians. How about the matter of money? All the aspects of money will be judged. Right, wrong, savings, blowing it, how we handled it, how we earned it, how we spent it, who we gave it to, who we shortchanged. You better handle it wisely to expect good. And whoso trusteth in the Lord, happy is he, blessed is he. So you put your trust with that verse in the matters of life. You will be happy and you will get good. What isn't a matter? There isn't a matter. Death, life, house, car, sleeping, awaking, your books, everything. Look up the word matter in your Bible. I mean, in the dictionary, excuse me. Matter is a solid. It's a liquid. It's a gas. It's a noun. It's a person, place, or thing. Be blessed by God, be blessed by God. Be happy by the Lord, by trusting in the Lord. And He'll entrust you with matters that you can get good from. The wise in heart shall be called prudent. Simple. And the sweetness of the lips increases learning. Now, we have sugar-coated preaching, and it does not increase learning. So that can't be what that verse is talking about. We got pansies and daffodil messages of lilies out there. And people are sitting under that preaching, dying and going to hell, or ending up naked at the judgment seat of Christ. So that verse can't... That, the Bible says, speaking of the word, as honey. That's a natural sweetener. It's the word. When you speak the word from your lips. Listen, if you're preaching on the street, you're knocking out doors and handing out gospel tracts, they're learning something, even though they don't like it. Maybe they had never heard they were going to hell. But if you preach, you're going to hell. You just increased in learning. What's this? Never seen one of these things before. It's about Jesus Christ, the gospel. You learn something. There's a piece of paper with Bible on it. You didn't learn the way of the Lord in salvation, but you learned, guess what? Now you need to watch out for pieces of paper, maybe about Jesus. Understanding is a wellspring, a deep well of life unto him that hath it. Understanding and knowledge of the holy. Remember, understanding the Bible is your relationship to God of what you know and how to know what you have. What you can do for God. That's a wellspring of life. Understanding is deep. I think the expression used to be. But the instructions of fools is folly. Has nothing to do with nothing. They waste your time. Where understanding is a glorious blessing of time. The heart of the wise teacheth his mouth. Oh, so you got to train your mouth. You got to teach your mouth to shut up. You got to teach your mouth when to speak. You got to teach your mouth what to speak. And addeth learning to his lips. Pleasant words are as an honeycomb. See what I mean? The honey, natural sweetener. Sweet to the soul. Sugar-coated preaching is not sweet to the soul. And health to the bones. Chapter 14, 12, Exodus 15, 26. Didn't we just read something last night about the bones? Let's see. Verse 30, the light of the eyes rejoiceth the heart, and a good report maketh the bones fat. The Bible can make you, listen, they say calcium good for the bones. So is Bible learning and applying the Bible to your life can make your bones good. I don't know how, but pleasant words are health to the bones. So what is it if you speak unpleasant words? What if you call your wife or girlfriend the B word? Or useless? Or what if you tell your children, you know, you're good for nothing? You're a burden on my life. you are causing a disease to the bones. I wonder if bone doctors ever discovered or ever done any some of the bones that problems and diseases that some of these people have today. If they were looking to who spoke to them and how did they speak to them. That would be an interesting study. Warning, your big mouth may call ulcers ferocious, whatever it's pronounced. There's a way that seemeth right unto man. Chapter 14, verse 12. Genesis 4, 5. But the end thereof are the ways of death. That's religion. That is science. That is education. That is government. We already read that. He that laboreth for himself. For his mouth craveth of him. Ecclesiastes chapter 6, verse 7. He said, well, I'm a man and I labor, I pay for my family. Yeah, but you are also included. The common denominator factor of is those who work is you will feed yourself. I don't think you will deny yourself. Listen, they're recorded in the Old Testament when the siege and the famine came in Jerusalem, there were women that were eating their own children. Forget feeding little darling. I'm going to eat you. You're going to feed me. How's that? Ooh, I hate to stop there with time, but an ungodly man diggeth up evil. He goes out there with a shovel. That is his labor. And his reward and his paycheck, evil. Ungodly men will get evil. And in his lips, there's as a burning fire, James chapter 3. And there is another example in your Bible of cigarettes and cigars. And it's a reference to an ungodly man, even if you are a Christian. A burning fire is found in the lips. A froward man soweth strife. You. Remember froward, he won't yield to God? So he goes out there and he picks strife, problems. And a whisperer separateth chief. Friends, chapter 6, verse 19. Did you hear about that guy? Why don't you say it out loud? People don't like when I yell on the streets. They like whispers. And whispers is a little secret little thing that other people are not supposed to hear. A violent man entices his neighbor. I'm trying to see my note for that one. I got James 1:14. And leadeth him into a way that is not good. Habakkuk 2:15. You better not walk with a violent man. Your way will turn out not good. Remember we just read about something about being good? Where is it? We already just read about a way of the good. We already learned it tonight, so let you go back. He shutteth his eyes. He, the violent man, shutteth his eyes, dream. Daydream, night dream, to devise forward things. What can I dream of now that's wicked? moving his lips, he bringeth evil to pass. That's Adolf Hitler. Brings it to pass, his action. Not only did he dream about it, but when he woke up, he put it into effect. The hoary head. A white head. Gray head. Is a crown of glory. Now, is there a period? No, there's a comma. This is conditional. Now, if you want to put a period here, everyone that has white hair and gray hair, oh, it's his glory. No. Sometimes a person may have white or gray hair because of their children. Or because of their job. Or because of their spouse. Or maybe because of a disease. Or worry. Or troubles. But the hoary head is a crown of glory if, conditional, it be found in a way of righteousness. Job 32:6. If a man gets gray hair or white hair as he's growing in the grace of the Lord, that is someone who's got age. That's someone who's got wisdom. That's somebody who's got experience. That's what it's talking about. He that is slow to anger is better than the mighty. Goliath. David was better than he was. Thought it out. And he that ruleth his spirit, man's spirit, he that ruleth his spirit, then he that taketh a city. Chapter 25:28. Alexander the Great could not control his lust, but he conquered the world. And go read how he died. At a young age. He conquered the whole world, but he couldn't conquer his lust. There are men out there, they got all the money. But all the sins they got, they can't get rid of. All right. Lot, the lot is cast into the lap. This is gambling and profits verse. But the whole dispositioning thereof is of the Lord. Now this was a prayer act of Acts 1:26. Say, Lord, we're going to have straws in our hand. The one that you want, you have that person pick the smallest straw. Lord, we have a difficult situation here. We're going to roll a dice. Odd, yes. Even? No. Lord God, bless this dice, not for gambling, but for, you know, do I plant corn or do I plant peas this year, Lord? Lord, there's eight other bids in this contract. Lord, how low can I go without going bankrupt that you will award me this contract? You know what it also says? For someone like I know, Pastor Bear out in Las Vegas. Hi, Mr. Homeless Man. Why are you homeless? Why are you here? Well, I went on the crap table and drew a three. And God said that three was the Lord's result. You're not supposed to be gambling. Scratched off all the tickets. I didn't win. That's the Lord. Scratched off the ticket. $1, $2. That's the Lord. I won $1,000,000. That's the Lord. My life is miserable. That's sin and evil and wickedness. There is no chance in the Bible. It's God. There is no luck in the Bible. It is God. Whether it be a wheel, dice, straws, cards, and even that little thing that Jewish people twirl on a Hanukkah. It's God. If it's a slot machine, it's God. There's a thing with gambling. Hey, it's my life work. I'm a construction. I'm a farmer. My children. I have an important decision to make. Or I'm going to just waste money to try to get more money, which I'm going to lose money in the end. He's a wolf, the farmer, you know. God said plant corn and, you know, all the crows and ate it. Maybe God's trying to see how well that man will handle it. I don't know. I'm just saying. That verse says it comes out to God's in control. That's what the Bible says. The Bible's right.